Come, come, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving. Ours is no caravan of despair. Come, yet again, come. Come, come, wanderer, worshipper, lover of leaving. Ours is no caravan of despair. Ours is no caravan of despair.
Your religious beliefs or lack of belief, you are welcome here.
No matter your age, sex, sexual orientation, or gender identity, you are welcome here.
No importa tu ciudadanía, tú estás bienvenido aquí.
No matter your citizenship, politics,
or relationship status.
No matter your physical characteristics or health, you are welcome here.
Whoever you are, wherever you are from,
you are welcome in this place.
Good morning and welcome to the online worship for the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Montgomery, located on the ancestral land of the Muscogee Creek people. It's March 7, 2021. We have a little bit different program today, and I'll let them explain.
Welcome. I'm Reverend Erica Hewitt, the Minister of Worship Arts at the Unitarian Universalist Association. I live on the ancestral lands of the Abenaki people on the coast of Maine, and my pronouns are she, her, hers.
I'm Reverend Vale Weller, Congregational Giving Director at the UUA. I live on the ancestral land of the Ohlone people in San Mateo, California, and I use she, her pronouns. This worship service is an offering from your UUA, WorshipWeb, our Stewardship and Development Department, and your UUA president. It's an expression of our covenant to and with each other.
You are part of us, and we are part of you. In our joyful process of collaboration with the stellar religious professionals you're about to meet, we centered our care for you, the congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association.
Even in these times when we are with one another virtually, let us remember that we belong to one another.
We are loved into being.
These are times of isolation and loneliness. Our hearts long for connection and for one another.
Illness has visited our lives. Struggle and pain are in our communities. Our children's lives have been disrupted. There has been such great loss.
And yet we are surrounded by beauty, by grace, and by music that blesses us.
All the while, we are surrounded by love. We are loved into courage.
We are loved into community. We are loved into generosity. We are loved into being. We are loved into being.
Come, let us open our hearts and grow the size of our souls. Come, let us worship together.
So I'd like to invite those who would wish to join in speaking our congregational covenant. We, the members and friends of the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Montgomery, promise to serve our community with open minds, willing hearts, and helping hands as we respect one another, honoring that our perceptions may differ, value our differences, working to better understand them in conflict, give joyfully of ourselves, being in harmony with our capabilities, and embrace our connections with each other, nature, the global community, and the great mystery of life. And now we're going to hear from our coordinator of religious education, Roger Burdett, with a time for all ages.
Good morning. Today, I'm going to do something a little different. I'm reading a children's story, but is it more than that? Now, this was, I'm pretty sure I bought this for my granddaughter. I'm borrowing it from her right now. Look, she's 2 years old. There's some wear and tear on this book, and there's one page that we can't read because it's been ripped out. But, you know, that's part of it belonging to a two-year-old. But I will argue that even though this is a children's book, older folks might also get something out of this. Because are you fully realized? Is there not a little more you could learn about yourself? I think there is. That's what I'm banking on. Welcome to Time for All Ages. So the book that we're looking at today is The Wonderful Things You Will Be. This is a Random House book, and they have given permission to read their books for a while longer online like this. So, The Wonderful Things You Will Be. I think you can get something out of this even if you're an old person like me. Because look, I am always discovering something new about myself. I hope I never stop. And I hope that's the same for you. So thank you to my granddaughter. This is a picture of my three grandchildren. And my granddaughter is the granddaughter in this photo. So thanks to her for letting me borrow her book, The Wonderful Things You Will Be by the number one New York Times bestseller, Emily Winfield Martin. When I look at you, and you look at me, I wonder what wonderful things you will be. When you were too small to tell me hello, I knew you were someone I wanted to know. For all of your tininess could not disguise a heart so enormous and wild and wise. And no matter what your age, this is me talking right now, no matter what your age, hopefully this still applies to you, right? This is the first time there's ever been you. So I wonder what wonderful things you will do. Will you stand up for good by saving the day? Or play a song only you know how to play? Will you tell a story that only you know? Will you learn what it means to help things grow? Will you learn how to fly, to find the best view, or take care of things much smaller than you? I know you'll be kind and clever and bold, and the bigger your heart, the more it will hold. when nights are black and when days are gray. You'll be brave and be bright so no shadows can stay. Then you'll discover all there is to see. And this is where I have a missing page, courtesy of my 2-year-old granddaughter. And then you'll discover all there is to see. And you get to fill in the next rhyme. Something that rhymes with see. And now for the big finale. And then I'll look at you. And you'll look at me. And I'll love you, whoever you've grown up to be. That is precious. I love it. I think it's positive. I think that applies to all of us, no matter your age. I wish you a really great week.
Each Sunday, we set aside a moment to lift up and let go the things that we have been carrying with us during the week. And so as we take this moment to breathe deeply in gratitude for those gathered here with us, I invite you to use the chat adjacent to the video to speak whatever is on your heart this morning, that we may be in community.
Sing with me,
There are sacred moments, sparkling moments, when we answer the call to live out our values and in so doing, bless the world beyond our imaginings. These powerful, sparkling moments are times when we are truly alive, when we feel and know and demonstrate our values because of the principles that have claimed us, because of this faith that we share, because we have been loved into being. It is time for the offering. This is a chance to give of your tangible energy to benefit the congregation which has nurtured and grown you, so that in turn it can be a powerful presence for future generations. This is an opportunity to make manifest generosity. This is an invitation to align resources and highest values. Susan Frederick Gray said, "The most important thing you can do for Unitarian Universalism is to generously support your congregation. It's transforming lives." Let us give now because our congregation is transforming lives and communities for the better. Let us give because we have been loved into being and because we want this same gift to be available to others. Let us give because we want generosity to be our response to the world. The offering will both be given and received with abundant gratitude.
You're broken down and tired. of living life on a merry-go-round. And you can find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we will walk it out.
Joining you here from First Parish in Cambridge. And I want to thank the First Parish community and Reverend Adam Lawrence Dyer for offering their space to us. First Parish sits on the occupied land of the Massachusetts people. A community of the Massachusetts people still live in Massachusetts in the community of Canton. I have a story for you today. And there's two things that are important about this story. Number one, it's a true story. And number two, it's an anonymous story. So I read this story many years ago in Yes Magazine, and the author of the story was listed only as Jane B. I love this story because it speaks to the fact that even in incredibly difficult circumstances, that the presence of love, that acts of generosity and hospitality really are life-saving. Here's Jane's story. Jane and her brother grew up in the 1940s in Hollywood, California, a town known for show business. Now, Jane says that she and her brother were adopted by their parents, not because their parents loved children, but because their parents thought it completed the image of the perfect Hollywood family, a beautiful home in Beverly Hills, a fleet of servants, two adorable children, and a little spaniel dog. Jane and her brother hardly ever saw their parents. They were largely raised by the housekeepers and nannies. It was only on Sunday when the whole family went to the country club. There, Jane and her brother were expected to be perfectly well behaved, not to run around or get dirty, to know which piece of silverware to use at every course, to be seen but not heard. They were taught to speak only when spoken to. Looking back, Jane said of herself, "I wasn't a real girl. I was a cardboard cutout of a girl." Jane's best memories from her childhood were when she was with her grandmother. And one day, her grandmother took her to a rummage sale in a church basement. Now, this was Hollywood, California, so this rummage sale was filled with costumes and fancy clothes that were from the movies or from movie stars. Jane's grandmother gave her $2, which was a lot of money at that time, and said, "Buy whatever you want." Well, Jane went home with two armfuls of things. And as soon as she got home, she ran straight up to her room with all of that loot. And she started trying things on. Finally, she settled on a little pink nightdress, a big broad hat, white satin gloves, and every piece of costume jewelry that she bought. She looked at herself in the mirror, and Jane was awestruck. She looked like a different person. She decided to give herself a new name, Madame Modifus. Now, whereas Jane was quiet, Madame Modifus was bold. And whereas Jane was shy, Madame Modifus was flamboyant. And whereas Jane always did exactly as she was told, well, Madame Modifus, she had a mind of her own. Jane, all dressed up, ran down the stairs across the yard to the house next door and knocked on the door. When the mother next door and her little son opened the door, their jaws fell open. Jane said, "My name is Madame Modifus. May I come in for tea?" Well, the mother and her son, they welcomed Jane into their home. They played for hours, and then Jane went back to her house. Now, any time that Jane had a little bit of time to herself, she would get all dressed up and she would run to the neighbor's house, and they just came to call her Madame Modifus. Jane ends her story by sharing how she now is a grandmother, and that one of her favorite things to do is to visit her own grandchildren, and that whenever she goes to see them, they wait for her outside on the yard, and when she pulls into the driveway, they jump up and down and scream her name, Madi, 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 the only name they've ever known her by. Yes, love is what I need to know my name. These words from the artist Seal capture the meaning of our story today, the story of Jane and her discovery of her full self and her real name, Madi. Jane's story captured my attention the first time I read it. Her words, "I wasn't a real girl. I was a cardboard cutout of a girl. They stayed with me." It's clear the trauma and the pain of her home life. And this isn't unique or even uncommon for children, for any of us.
So many of us know these experiences in our home lives, in our work lives, or in the stifling cultural conditions of oppression that seek to make us small, quiet, invisible. Conditions that seek to rob us of our fullness. But then something happens for Jane. Through the love of her grandmother, the generous embrace of the neighbors, and a little bit of imagination, Jane's full self, Maudie, finds expression. The freedom she experiences is in moments. Those moments when she's able to steal away from her house and go to her neighbors. But it is enough. These small moments of joy and love in the midst of the neglect and the suffering, they are life-saving. Zora Neale Hurston writes, "Love makes your soul crawl out from its hiding place." And that is exactly what Maudie's soul does. She is loved into the fullness of her being. I hear echoes of my own story in this story. And maybe you do too. For me, in a time of tremendous difficulty in my life, my UU church was the neighbor's house, full of warmth and welcome, music and imagination. And the grandmother? That was my Sunday school teachers, whose love and care, coupled with joy and attention, it made a difference in my life when I most needed it. That congregation, that community, those teachers, they helped me find my voice, my spirit, my soul. They loved me into being. I imagine that you too have stories like this. How Unitarian Universalism, its theology, its people, its ministry changed you, saved your life, helped your soul crawl out of its hiding space. How it helped grow the size of your soul. As process theologian Bernard Loomer so powerfully describes, by size, I mean the stature of a person's soul, the range and depth of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your being and still maintain your integrity and individuality. There's so much expansiveness and generosity in Loomer's definition of the size of your soul. And he goes on. He says, "I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer in the development in their diversity and uniqueness. I mean the magnanimity of concern to provide conditions that enable others to increase in stature." You see, Loomer is not just talking about individual growth and liberation. And this matters to us as Unitarian Universalists because our faith has never been solely about individual spiritual growth. As Unitarian Universalists, we understand salvation not as individual, but collective. We recognize the fundamental interconnectedness, interdependence of all life and of humanity. Foundational to the core theological idea of interdependence is that mutuality and responsibility are inherent to who we are as human beings. We are not islands. And our tradition calls us not to individual freedom or transformation alone, but to the liberation and thriving of all people. One of the most important and successful campaigns within Unitarian Universalism over this past year was UU the Vote, a national effort for Unitarian Universalists to partner with local grassroots organizing and voting rights groups on an unprecedented voter engagement, voter registration, and voter turnout effort. It was the first ever effort like this on our part as a larger association, and it was awesome. But here's something you may not know about UU the Vote. When I first shared the idea for UU the Vote at the 2019 General Assembly, I didn't know if it would take hold. I was simply throwing out a seed of a dream, imagining there before thousands of you, congregational delegates at GA, I asked, what if we as UUs helped engage and mobilize 1 million people to vote in the 2020 election? When I said that, it was scary. It seemed impossible. And in fact, the next time I talked about UU the Vote at a local congregation, I reduced the number to 500,000. But before we'd even started to create the team and the infrastructure, when we were still just talking about this idea, congregational leaders, ministers, religious educators, and members were clamoring to volunteer. Financial gifts began coming in, some unsolicited. Folks were ready to say yes, ready to give generously of their time and resources because they knew that our values of justice and compassion, that our system of democracy and the literal lives and well-being of our neighbors, of our loved ones, of each other, were on the line and on the ballot. Thousands of people volunteered. Thousands of donors came forward from our congregations, many of you. And together we invested tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of hours and well over $1 million to vote love in the 2020 election. And in the end, we reached well over 3 million potential voters, far exceeding our wildest dreams. In what was the largest, most transparent and accessible election in our history, we UUs played a significant role. And we were likely the largest, most organized, faith-based pro-democracy effort during the election. Wow. Imagination, generosity, commitment, collective action, these fueled UU the Vote. But there was also some magic to it, because it recognized our strengths and it invited us more fully into who we are. For we are the people who show up. We are the people who work together in community. We are people who believe in democracy, who understand our faith as active, who are concerned about the conditions of justice here and now, and who, when it comes right down to it, are a hopeful people. We are a hopeful people about what is possible and about our agency and capacity to meet the challenges of our time. Some of the magic of UU the Vote was that together we were loving each other into the fullness of who we are as Unitarian Universalists. But this isn't the end of the story. It is a reminder. It is a glimpse of what is possible when we say yes. When we say yes so generously and powerfully to what we believe in, to what we care about, to our ministries, our values, and when we choose solidarity, interdependence with wider networks of people working for justice, compassion, and liberation. From the beginning of my time as UUA president, I have said, this is no time for a casual faith. No time for a casual commitment to what you love most. And this is no time to go it alone. UU the Vote is just one example of what it looks like to take our faith, our values, and our commitment to interdependence seriously. It is life-saving, life-changing ministry. Individually in our own lives, and revolutionary when we bring that powerful yes out into the world. And this yes, This yes is what is needed so deeply in our communities and our world right now. To love our society, to love our world into a new place of being. In her important book, Cast, Isabel Wilkerson explores the conditions of racism, white supremacy, and racial hierarchy as an American caste system. And in her book, she quotes Gary Michael Tartikoff, an American scholar of castes, who says of the United States, "This is a civilization searching for its humanity. It dehumanized others in order to build its civilization, and now it needs to find its own." There's power in those words and that history. So how do we find our humanity as a society, as a country, as a civilization? The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King said the key was love. By love, King did not mean a sentimental or romantic kind of love, but rather an overflowing, audacious, and unconditional love that sought the fullest unfolding of every person. King said, "This love might well be the salvation of our civilization." The only way that we overcome the forces of racism, domination, discrimination, dehumanization, the forces that are at the foundation of the United States, those forces that have the effect of dehumanizing our society, the only way we overcome those forces is to turn to the deepest source of our humanity. And as Unitarian Universalists, we know that that foundation, that source of our humanity, is our compassion and our interdependence, our mutuality and relationship and responsibility to each other. In other words, I would take Bernard Loomer's words and King's words and say, we need to grow the size of our love. And by size, as Loomer says, I mean the range and depth of your love, your capacity for relationships. I mean the volume of life you can take into your being. I mean the strength of your spirit to encourage others to become freer, to provide conditions that enable others to increase their stature, the size of their love and their soul. And this is where the real spiritual depth and calling of our faith lives. Not just as an intellectual exercise, but as embodiment. Embodying and growing our capacity for this powerful form of love that encourages all of us to live into the fullness of our being and that is committed to the conditions that make this fullness possible for everyone. Compassion. Interdependence. Looking back, the love of her grandmother, that trip to the church rummage sale, and the generous, inclusive embrace of her neighbors made a powerful difference to young Jane, to Maudie. Looking back, the warmth and magic of my UU church and the love and care of my Sunday school and youth leaders shaped my life and my calling in ways that I will always be grateful for and will never be able to repay. Looking back, UU The Vote became this incredible source of community, joy, and positive action in the midst of what was one of the most traumatic times in our lives. It drew us together in unprecedented ways and was a lifeline. And this is not the end of the story. It's just a glimpse, just a few stories to capture some of what is possible in all of our congregations when we say yes. When we say yes boldly, audaciously, powerfully to our values, to our spirits and our love, and to one another. These stories and more are happening all across our congregations. None of us will ever know all the difference that our generosity to our congregations has made to the lives of our children, our families, our elders, to the lives and conditions of our larger communities. We'll never know all the ways that we have helped make a difference. When we give boldly, generously, audaciously of our financial resources as we are able, we make our values and our ministry manifest in the world. When we give generously of our hearts and our care and our love to our children and families, elders and adults, young adults and youth, we change lives. We save lives. And when we dream big, as leaders and staff, about the impact we are called to make in the wider world, lives are changed. The material conditions of our communities can change. We are changed. We make it possible, loved into fullness, loved into being. May we keep saying yes, boldly, courageously, and lovingly to our values and our faith. May it be so.
It's not the waking or the rising. It's the grounding of a foot I'm compromising. It's not forgoing of the light. It's not the opening of the eyes. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the shade we should be casting. It's the light and it's the obstacle that cast it. It's the heart that drives the light. It's the fire it ignites. It's not the waking, it's the rising. It's not the song, but it's the singing. It's the heaven of the human spirit breathing. It is the bringing of the light. It is the bearing of the rhyme. It's not the waking, it's the rising. And I could cry power.
Well, the service has been a gift to me, and I hope to you as well. And please join us. We'll be having discussion over on Zoom for our second hour, doing it a little bit differently. This week, we're going to split up into smaller groups so that we can have more actual conversation. So the link is there. There are a lot of things going on, and watch for an email from me today or tomorrow coming out through the Beacon News. And if you're not subscribed to our email, please go to our website. The front page at the bottom has the link to subscribe. That's the best way to keep in touch with what's going on, along with the Facebook group has announcements and conversation among the community going on there. So hope to see you soon. And for now, our service has ended. May our service begin.